Now we can move to next hands-on, which will be again because on our Nucleo we have only our LED and one button. It will be also again cooperation between LED and the button. But now we do this with a little bit different way. We will use the button not as the standard floating input, but we will use this as an interrupt. We set the button to create the interrupt, which will be handled with our application, and in the interrupt, we will change the state of the button. Then I think will be a very nice example to show you the different things, which is the base for the microcontroller, and this is the interrupt. How to set up the interrupt and how to start working with the interrupts. Then we first start with the new project. I will start my new project in the selector. I will select again the F4 401. I will select the package. In my case is the LQFP64, which is my Nucleo, and the microcontroller is 512 kilobyte flash device. The STM32F401 RET. I will select this one and I will wait. Okay. First of all, I will select the PA5 because I know that the LED is on the PA5. Then I select this pin as output. I think label is now not necessary. And now the input. I know that the PC13 is my GPIO pin. I can check this pin here. But you know that this is the pin which is connected to PC13, connected with the pull-up resistor. Then when we press the button, we will create falling edge on the pin. This is also good to know. Okay, then we select the pin PC13 and we not set it as an input, but we select the GPIO pin as a XT pin 13. It's mean the XT mean the external interrupt controller. And we set this as a XT 10. If you have the same configuration, one pin as an output, second one as the GPIO XT, then you have the same situation as me. That's good. Clocks we can left unchanged because I'm okay with 16 megahertz for this application. But we now need to look on the configuration. First of all, we check the GPIO settings. Now the GPIO, the PA5, this is our LED. Okay, the output level after initialization will be low. This is perfect. GPIO mode push-pull, so okay, no pull-up, no pull-down resistor, perfect for me. And the maximum speed is low. This is okay. And now pin PC13. Now we see the GPIO mode is set as the external interrupt mode. This is okay with rising edge trigger detection. Rising edge in our case is the releasing the button. Then we don't want the react on the releasing the pin, the button. Then we look on the different mode. We have the falling edge, we can create the interrupt. And we have also, we can react on the falling or the rising edges. And there are also more modes. There is the external event mode. What is the difference between the external event and the external interrupt? The difference is that the external event mode not create the interrupt. The microcontroller not stop processing the main program and jumps into interrupt. In the event, the microcontroller continues. The event mode is mainly used for the wake-upping microcontroller for the low power mode when we don't want enter the interview team. But for our case, we will use the external mode with falling edge trigger detection. Then this is okay. You can save this. And now, second part which we need to handle here, it's the NVIC controller, because we not set the external interrupt. One part is the GPIO, which create the notification for the core that we want to create the interrupt. And second part is the NVIC controller, which is embedded inside the core, which also need to allow this interrupt for processing. Then we open the NVIC. What we can see here? We can see here the priority bits. This is okay, but definitely we can search for our interrupt. And we're using the XT. Then we need to enable also this XT interrupt. And I click here and it's enabled. This is perfect. Then after this, I will jump into the interrupt. Okay. Then can save my project to my projects. I will use now the system workbench, why not? And I will name it as the XT1 lab. I click on the OK and I can generate my project. Okay. When everything is okay, I can run my system workbench. Okay, here, I select my workspace, it's okay for me. Now I have here my workspace. We have delete previous projects from my workspace. This is not necessary. And I need to import the last one. I will open the import. I will open the general import from existing project. Here I open the selector. Example projects, and here is my XT lab. Click on the import, and it's here in my project. Okay, main is always the same. I have the HL init. We talk about this, it's necessary. I have my clock configuration. It's also necessary, and I have my GPIO init. Now I can look what is inside my GPIO init. What we can see, we enabling the port C, port A. This is necessary. But here we can see that the pin for the button is set as the in the interrupt mode to rack on the falling edge. Everything is okay, but something new. You can see we also here enabling the NVIC, the nested interrupt vector controller for our button. Then after this initialization, the microcontroller, when the interrupt came, we jump into the interrupt routine. Now, where to find the interrupt routine is here in our not in the main.c file, but is here in the STM32F4X6_IT file. Then here are all interrupt routines which I use now. Then we can see the non-maskable interrupt, hard fault handler in case that we do something wrong, or some pointers will allow the code into the unhandled memory, some memmanage handler, bus fault handler, user fault, usage fault handler, debug monitor handler. We have here our SysTick, which is periodic interrupt from our core timer, which create the interrupt each 1 millisecond. which is automatically configured with the HA library. But here we have our XT interrupt handler, which handles interrupts from the pins from the 10 to 15. Because we have pin 13, it will be handled in this interrupt. Then how to handle the interrupt? You can see that the QPMX create here the function which for us will handle the interrupts. This means that when the microcontroller or the external peripheral triggers the interrupt, the microcontroller jumps into this routine. And the correct handling of the interrupts depends on the peripheral, but usually you need to clear some bits in the registers to allow the microcontroller leave the interrupt. If we not clear all the bits, which is necessary to do, the description is usually in the reference manual, we can enter again this interrupt routine and we will be here trapped forever in the loop. Then for this, the QPMX create for us the HL library IRQ handler, which will clear all these bits for us. This is very nice because we don't need now to read the reference manual, check which bits need to be cleared. Then this is nice automatic part, also nice feature of the HAL. But now, how to be notified about the interrupt? For this, the HL library use the callbacks. Then for us, it's only a question how to find the callbacks, which is used inside this IRQ handler. For this, we go into the drivers, into the HL drivers, into the sources, and we go into the gpl.c. And we know that all the callbacks are defined as underscore weak. Then we will try to find this function. I will try, and if I what I find here the HAL underscore gpl underscore xt underscore callback. This seems that I can use this function because this function will be called from my interrupt in the interrupt HL handler. And how to use this? I will copy this part because it's defined as a weak. That this mean the weak mean that if he not found this function in my code, he used this one. But if he found this one somewhere else in the code without weak, he will use the different definition. Then I put it inside my main. I put it here on the top. It's not so correct. Correct place will be here on the bottom in section 4. But this is closer to my main. I will use this part. Okay, and now I defined my callback. Then when I will go into the interrupt, the HL library, the HL IRQ handler will notify me with this callback. And I can put here some action. When I discover this callback, then I put here the HL underscore GPIO underscore toggle pin. It will be the GPIO A and GPIO underscore pin underscore 5, which is my LAT. I store this. I store my file. Now I can compile my file. Okay, my build finished. No error reported. It's good. Then I can here create my debug configuration. I double click on the AC6 STM32 debugging. the window will pop up. And I will create new board for this. You can use existing board if you want. And I only here select the correct debugger, which is the Stealing version 2.1. This will be correct. And I can start debug. Why not? Yes, I want to go into the debugging perspective. Okay, we can run the code. No problems. And when I press the button, my LED is on. When I press it again, LED is off. Perfect. Also, what you need to be careful, in case that you have the different button configuration or you connect the button on your own, be careful with the debouncing effect when the button without the filtering capacitor can create some bouncing noise, and then you the microcontroller can register multiple falling edges. Then be careful. In my case, in our Nucleo, in this connection, you can see there is 100 nanofarad capacitor, which will help to filter this noises, which created the switching, the button on and off.